Next, let me talk about flow control and how resources are managed on a network. So if you're trying to send a message from A to B, right? If it's a really large message, then what you want to do is break up that message into smaller packets. Okay, so one message gets broken up into, you know, many smaller packets. And the reason we're doing this is because if I work with smaller units, it gives me a better chance of kind of filling my network with these units that are all, you know, perhaps making forward progress. Okay, now this is similar to, you know, taking a bucket and trying to fill its entire volume, right? You have a better chance of doing that if you use fine grains of sand versus if you use, you know, large boulders of rock. Okay, so similarly, you know, when you're trying to inject things into a network, you want to inject entities that are fairly small, because that allows that entity to kind of, you know, find a way to get to the destination by causing, you know, as little intrusion as possible. Okay, so I want to take this one large message and break it up into n small packets. And, you know, each packet is now allowed to follow its own path to get to B, right? So every packet can take its own route, which means that each packet could take a different amount of time to get to B. So ultimately, when all of these packets arrive in B, they have to all be reassembled. Okay, so this means that every packet has some kind of header information, which allows that packet to know exactly where it is going, that it's going from A to B, and that it is part of this larger message, so it can be reassembled. Okay, so every packet needs a header. Okay, and this means that I can't make my packets extremely small, because if I make my packets extremely small, that header overhead starts to increase. Okay, so you can assume that, you know, let's say that this header is about, you know, 2 bytes in size. Okay, so if my packet is, say, you know, 64 bytes in size, then having a 2-byte overhead is perhaps tolerable. Okay, but if my packet size is only 8 bytes, then that's a fairly significant overhead. That's about a 25% overhead in terms of energy and in terms of consuming the available bandwidth. Okay, so, you know, packets are kept relatively large to reduce this header overhead. But ultimately, if you look at a link between two routers, you know, that link may only be a 64-bit wide link, okay, which means that, you know, you have 64 different wires. And so at a time, you can only ship 64 bits of data across from one router to the next in a given cycle. Okay, so this unit, the unit of, you know, of what gets transferred in one cycle over one link, is called a flit. Okay, so a flit in this example is 64 bits wide. Okay, now, you know, so essentially what I'm doing is taking my packet, let's say a 64 byte packet, and I'm breaking it up into these 64 bit units. I'm breaking them up into many different flits. So if I do have a 64 byte packet, that gets broken up into 8 64 bit flits. Okay, and each flit basically goes over this network, you know, one cycle at a time. Now, you know, each flit cannot be completely independent. If I let, you know, the different flits of a packet take their own paths to go from A to B, then essentially, you know, each flit is like a packet itself. That is, each flit would need some header information so that it knows how to get to the destination, and so that packet can be reassembled at the destination. Okay, so obviously I can't keep adding headers because that increases overhead. So the flits really don't have any headers. Okay, so, you know, once a packet starts to go over a link, okay, so here's a router. As a packet starts to go over the link, that packet is broken up into many flits. The first is the head flit, then you can have a bunch of body flits, and then finally a tail flit. Okay, and none of these flits have any kind of header information on them. It's only the header flit that has the packet header in it, which allows me to figure out exactly, you know, where is this packet headed and how do I send it over there. Okay, but all of the other flits, you know, don't have additional headers on them, right? So all of my header information for the packet is localized to this head flit, and all of these don't have any headers at all. So for them to know where they're headed, they just basically have to say that I'm just following the guy in front of me. Okay, so this body flit is just going to follow the head flit, and whatever I do for the head flit, if I send the head flit towards the north, I also have to send the body flit to the north right behind it. Okay, and to prevent any kind of confusion, you know, while this packet is going over the link, a different packet can't cut in, right? Otherwise, I would get confused about, you know, which flit belongs to whom, right? So since the flits don't have any header information, I'm required to ensure that each flit kind of follows the flit right in front of it. Okay, so when the head flit goes through a router, the flits behind it are assumed to be the body flit until you finally see a tail flit. and that tail flit is then assumed to be the last flit in this packet. The next thing that I'm going to see is likely to be a new head flit for a new packet. Okay, so you know, this is how I kind of take a large message, break it up into smaller packets, and each packet itself is broken up into smaller flits based on how much can be sent over a link in one given cycle. In this case, that amount was 64 bits. Okay, so in the on-chip network world, if you look at the messages being sent on the network, they are usually, you know, they are usually either 64 bits in size, where I'm making a request for an address, or I'm sending out an invalidation for a given address, and so on. Or I could be transferring an entire cache line itself, which could be about 64 bytes in size. Okay, so there are usually, you know, two different options. I'm either sending a 64-bit entity, or I could be sending a 512-bit entity, or, you know, maybe a 576-bit entity, because your cache line has to be accompanied with some address as well and some control information. So in this case, you essentially have, you know, one packet, which is one flit in size. And in this case, you have one packet that is composed of 9 flits. Okay, so you know, most messages being sent on the network are all composed of a single packet, because our messages never become too large. And each packet is itself composed of either one flit or 9 different flits.